This is how we're gonna start. And so basically we are right now doing a mastering API testing with Postman. And in the end, we have some live projects, but in this live projects, you will be doing practical stuff. You'll have worksheet and checklist that we're gonna share. And this is where the important thing comes. Whenever we do workshops, we don't check the assignments. Right now in this one, we're going to check the assignments also, and we're going to discuss what are the assignments or worksheet that you have filled, right? So that's where it is important. Everything, whatever you are learning, every action that you are taking, make sure you are doing something, right? And you are writing the test cases that we're going to discuss. So we'll have some API testing basics. We'll work with Postman, Newman. After that, we'll have a couple of live projects. We'll see how they work and what are the things that we have written. We're going to have some Jenkins CI/CD, right, that we're going to cover. And after that, we'll basically resolve your doubts, so you can say in a simple manner. It's a Q&A session, right? So, all right. So let's start with a simple concept related to it. Before we start with what is API testing, let's start with why API testing, right? So why API testing is important, let me tell you in a simple manner. Why we are learning API testing first is that there are a couple of reasons. Couple of reasons basically means the most important reason is that millions of web apps as well as mobile applications are using APIs, right? So APIs are application programming interface. They basically allow any kind of a two different application to communicate with each other, right? For example, you have a client, you have a server, they are written in a different language, right? So client can be HTML, JavaScript, React Native, any kind of a language, right? That you are saying, for example, the website that you are using, it is in HTML, React, Angular, Vue.js. So it can be anywhere. So your front end can be anywhere in that case, right? It is getting communicated with a server. Server is basically written in Python, PHP, C#, or anything like this, right? So APIs allowed you to communicate between these two different applications, right? And right now, why it is important API testing? Because millions of web apps application like Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Foursquare, Zoom, even Zoom that you are using are right now using the APIs, right? They are using web APIs. So we are learning only the web APIs. If you talk about the APIs, APIs are very common terminology. And even your operating system uses the API to communicate between software, hardware, and that case, right? But we are not using it. We are only using for the web application. That's why we call it web services in that case also. Make sense? Right? So one of the important reasons people miss in the interview is that why API testing is important is due to this microservices architecture, right? So what exactly it is, the diagram says all, but here is the definition. Microservices basically is the architectural style that structures any kind of application as a collection of service. In a simple manner, microservices, if you see here, right? Right now, if you see, generally, whenever we are creating any kind of a web application, right? For example, we are creating a banking web application. The UI business logic is basically where the logic written that manager will able to submit a form, or client can submit any kind of a form, right? So any kind of a business logic, as well as a data access layer. Data access layer is nothing but the whatever you want to work on databases, right? Everything, if you talk about in monolithic architecture, is in a single, you can say they are very tightly coupled in that case, right? But here as if we talk about in microservices, every unit, for example, accounting, inventory, or user management, any kind of a management that you have seen, is in a different, you know, is a different application. It's a separate small application that basically will help you to communicate with each other. Now, how they are communicating? Because they are different, right? Accounting, inventory management, user management, these kind of four services are different, right? How they are communicating? They are communicating using the APIs. So that's where the microservices architecture comes. And why it is important? Because let me pull up my screen. Microservices are highly maintainable and testable. So that's why it is important. And right now, most of the companies are moving towards the microservices. And even if you don't know, your company will be already using microservices, and they are using internally certain kind of internal APIs that they communicate, and those API need to be tested, right? These microservices are loosely coupled. They are independently deployable. That's where it is an important one. User management can be a separate part from your web application. For example, if you have a Facebook, right, the user management part where login of the user happens and the authentication and authorization part, it can be a separate than the like, photos upload and something like this, right? So it's basically independent in that case. It is owned by a small team and organized around the business capabilities, right? So you can read more about this on this link, microservices.io. It's awesome resource. And one of the important question for the API testing about the microservices is this, right? So make sure you read about the microservices, right? So people are going to ask you this thing. So this is how, if you talk about microservice look like, for example, we have accounting service. For example, a mobile application is there, a browser is there, right? We have API gateways, storefront. If you see every kind of a, if you see this square, right? So they are different applications, small application like account service, inventory service, shipping service, and they are communicating each other with the REST APIs, if you see, right? So that's why API testing is important. One of the important reason why we are using APIs now is due to the microservices architecture. I hope that makes sense. Make sense? Type yes in the comment, guys, if you are able to understand the microservices. Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes. So now Linting also have the idea about the microservices, and he used to ask. Right. Right. So microservices, people will ask you, and right now big corporations are still using microservices, and they require certain kind of API testing in that case. And if you know those concepts, trust me, people will use your skills in that. Basically, I mean to say. Now, why API testing is important and why we have used it. Another important reason why it is very similar is basically the UI testing part. Basically, UI testing right now, if you have seen, it is very costly in nature, right? And why UI testing is costly? Because locator changes. One of the important reason is locator changes, as well as right now people are using moving toward the PWA, which is progressive web applications. They have dynamic locators, right? So it's very difficult to maintain the locators as well as the overall framework that you are using in the UI testing, right? So that's where, and as well as right now people are moving toward the asynchronous nature of the web application. So if you see React, Vue.js, Angular, all these framework are internally using something known as XHRs or asynchronous calls, right? So those will basically make your automation framework, which you have made for UI testing, it's very costly and highly maintainable, right? So that's where API testing comes in handy. So if you see the graph here, cost and complexity, right? Right. So if you see it, right, if developer write the unit test cases, that is again very cheap. If it is API layer, which is basically somewhere in the middle between the UI and the unit test. So if you're writing here, it's very good. But if you're writing here, the cost increases, if you see, right? And after that, we have manual and ETs. But the speed, if you see, decreases in that case, right? So UI test cases are very slow, as well as APIs are, of course, faster than the UI. But the unit test cases are super fast. But most of the time, even if you read the state of testing, right, people, developers are not writing unit test cases. And that's what actually doing in that case. Right. All right. Let me remove this. Right. So now question arises, what is an API, right? So API basically stands for the application programming interface, right? So I know lots of people have already seen this example, but all the people who are new, it's very similar to the waiter that you have seen in the restaurant, right? So you are, for example, there is a particular client who is basically asking for something. For example, it is asking any kind of a food, right? It will basically see in the menu and want the food. So waiter will come and ask you, okay, what are the things that you want? And it will basically take the order from you, and it will go to the chef and basically tell, okay, these are the things they want. chef will prepare the food, and again waiter will basically give you the food in that case, so as a client, right? So right now, if you see, if you directly tell the client, if the client directly tell the chef, I need this, right? So there can be a communication gap, or client is right now, if you see in the real world scenario, client is using certain kind of a different language, right? It can be like using React or Angular or front end. It can, if it is a UI layer, it can be using certain kind of a different programming language. It cannot directly contact with chef in that case. It requires certain kind of a middleware who will basically translate all the things that I am saying, right, to the chef, right? So that's where it can comes handy. APIs are very much similar to the waiter. They are basically communicating, basically allowing you to communicate with your client and the server, right? So this is how actually it looks like in a practical manner. You have a web browser that you are using. You have your web application that you are seeing. So you are seeing most of the time HTML, CSS, JavaScript in that case. But in the nutshell, behind the scene, they are already calling any kind of a REST API, or right now most of the people are using REST. People are moving towards GraphQL and all. But yeah, so they are communicating with the server, which is a backend, right? So all the business logic are basically nothing but the APIs in that case. So business logic layer, where the business logics happen, they are using APIs, right? And what is API? It is nothing but it's basically a collection of functions and procedures, right? So these are just certain kind of a functions that basically allow you to communicate between any kind of a two applications, right? So what are the different types of REST API? So we are only covering REST API. Why? Because REST API, most of the company will be using. And if you have the understanding of REST API, then it basically works. And about, I would say, lots of people are still using on the REST API. So that's where we will mostly pay attention to it. All right. So we have, if you talk about the web APIs, we have Simple Object Access Protocol, which is called as SOAP. And people before REST API were using SOAP. And SOAP was mostly, I guess, introduced by Microsoft guys, where SOAP is similar to the envelope that you have already sent. So I'm going to give you this example. And after that, we have remote procedure calls, where remote procedure calls are basically, you can call any kind of a procedure or a function on the server by hitting or using certain kind of mechanisms, right? And the third one was the representational state transfer. It was nothing but a architectural design for API testing, and that is REST. And REST we are going to discuss heavily in this course, right? Because REST is important, and most of the time while you're working with API testing, you will be working with the REST, right? And we are going to cover some of the point about the GraphQL, right? And in the end, right? So people are still using started using GraphQL, right? Till now it makes sense, guys. Type yes in the comment if it is making sense. What is API testing and why you do API testing? All right. Okay. So I know lots of you guys, it's a revision, but yes, for the new folks, it will be very new concept, right? And when we do the practical stuff, everything will be clear, guys. This is one of the important theoretical concept that you should know. These are like basic pillars. After that, we'll start with our Postman. We'll do some JSON schema validation. I'm going to explain you step by step everything. And after that, I'm going to show you how to do with the practical examples for live projects. So we'll go step by step, but we need to have some basic understanding first about the API testing. That's what it is important, right? So if someone asks you what is REST, we're going to explain. So REST is basically an acronym for representational state transfer. It is nothing but a architectural style which basically describes the six constraints. So if in a nutshell, in a very simple manner, if I tell you, it's in a simple term, REST is nothing but a design pattern for web APIs, right? So if any kind of a API, web API, basically follows these six constraints, we call it is a REST API, right? And RESTful in that case, right? It is one of the thing which this constraint was actually made by Roy Fielding. You can read about it. He's a very famous person. And he basically in his doctorate, when he was doing the PhD and doctorate in that case, he created this restful style. And that's where it comes in handy. And right now, if you see about 60%, 65% of people are using REST, and most of the company that you will be working on are leveraging REST APIs. And whenever they are saying API testing, it is nothing but the REST API testing, right? Awesome. So what are the six constraints about the REST? So if we talk about it, we have six constraints, which is uniform interface, stateless, cacheable, client server, layered architecture system, and code on demand. So now let me explain you everyone about this. So you can go to this link, you can read more about them. Let me go through one by one what exactly it is and why it is important to know that. Yes. All right. So first constraint basically talks about the uniform interface. And guys, pay attention, because this is one of the important API interview question also. Basically, what are the six constraints? People will say, okay, what are the six constraints? And what exactly they are? You should know at least a line about them. What are they? Right. So uniform constraint, if we talk about, right, it's basically a interface between a client and server. Right. So if you have seen the diagram, let me show you where it is. Right. So this is the client that we are seeing, that web browser, and this is the server. Right. So uniform interface basically means that we basically define certain kind of a constraint so that client and server can communicate with each other. Right. So they basically, client and server are agreeing that they are agreeing to a certain rules that how they will basically communicate. So what kind of resources they will say. The client will say that, okay, my headers are content type JSON, right? So I want in a response JSON only. I can understand only JSON. So that's what actually they are telling, right? And server is telling that I am sending you this response. It's in JSON format. Please understand this. So they are agreeing on some uniformity. So that's where it basically means. Or a uniform interface in this simple manner, right? I'll request you to read more about it in the first go through. If you go through all the first one in a simple way, you'll not able to understand at the first time. But second time or third time, whenever you read, it will be simple. It is a simple way. Link, please. Okay. Let me give you this link. Read about it. One of the important interview question. One important question. Uniform interface is, again, I was saying, it's a very simple way. We are just agreeing client and server that I will send you whatever the content type, whatever the headers that I'm going to say, what are the meme type basically, right? It is basically meme, basically means media object. What are the media object I'll say? If I am sending you image, if I'm sending you text file, JSON, anything like this, or what kind of encoding I will be sending you, right? So that's what actually we are agreeing on. Stateless, it's very simple. It basically means that client and server don't worry about the state or response and request. So they don't care about what is the state of it. They'll just, client will basically do a request and forget about it. And server will basically receive the request and just respond back, whatever the client was asking in that case, right? Again, I'm telling you in the first nuts, in the first time, you'll not able to understand, but if you read 2-3 times, you will be able to understand this. Cacheable is a very simple thing that you already have seen, caching, right? So caching is generally basically means that, okay, what you can, client can cache certain kind of resources. For example, if you are keep on asking, what is the role number one? So if you are hitting a API endpoint, if you are saying, what is a role number one? So the server can say that, okay, you can cache this resource. For example, if this API is basically getting used by certain kind of a web every time, so they can cache it. And it's up to the server when they want the cache to expire. So they will basically give you a certain kind of a time frame, right? And let me show you if I can show this thing. So I have opened the, right? So if I can show you certain things. So cache control, if you see, no cache. So they are saying code, no cache. And sometimes you will see certain kind of a date here, right? So where they will basically tell you that, okay, the server will basically tell you that after this, it will expire in that case, right? So this is again constrained. It should be cacheable. Client server basically means that whenever we are using any kind of API, there should be two entities. One will the client and second will the server. as you can see, we have client, we have server. That's what actually they are saying. Layered architecture is basically means that between client and server, there can be number of layers. It can be security, right? So if you have seen, your web application are directly communicating with server, right? They are not actually. They are basically going towards, they'll have certain kind of firewalls in the front of it. And after that, it can be more security layers, some VPNs, certain like this. And after that, they will eventually hit the server. And after that, it will go back to the client, right? So layer architecture, it basically means that client server can, there can be number of layer system. It doesn't matter. So it can be there, right? And this is again a optional constraint, which basically means that server can store the code or a logic to themselves and transfer it whenever they require. So for example, there's a particular API which basically calculates 2 plus 2, right? And it is giving you right now 2 plus 2 as a 6. So client doesn't know how it is giving 2 plus 2 is equal to 6, right? And if client wants to get the code, it can request by using certain mechanism. And so that is where it basically code on demand. Whenever you ask from a server, I want the code exactly what you are doing, what is the business logic that you are doing, client can do that in that case. Right. So these are the 6 major constraints that you should know. And if any kind of a API fulfills these 6 constraints, we call them a RESTful API. Make sense? Make sense, guys? Type yes in the comment if you are able to understand. And again, I know you have to read twice or thrice to understand this. And whenever you are doing practical, you will automatically be able to understand what's going on behind this. Right. Even if you are not able to understand, don't worry. Just rewatch the video or read this article. I have written extensively what is it. And I'm going to share a few more articles which are give you more perspective, more in depth about these 6 constraints. Right. So number one, REST tutorial. The one of the important link that I would like to give you. REST, yes, this one. How they get the code? They will basically use certain kind of HTTP methods like options and all, but that is again out of scope from this class. But I can show you how basically you can ask for a code or a business logic from the server also if you want it to, but server has to support first, right? This is the resource, restapitutorial.com. Make sure you read more about it. So they have given more about the uniform interface, stateless, right? And cacheable layer system, code on demand, right? So make sure you go through them at least once and able to understand what exactly going on, right? In the interview, people generally ask about the basics of it, not in very depth, how the cacheable is implemented, right? How this is implemented, they will not ask you in the API interview. But you should know what exactly is a cacheable. It just means that server basically allow client to cache, and server can basically expire any kind of a resource. So resource here I'm talking about is the any kind of a text file, image file, right? So if you have seen certain kind of images expire after few seconds or few minutes, right? Or there is a particular data that expires after 5 minutes. So server can say that, okay, this is the expiry of it. Client, you can cache till 5 seconds or 5 minutes or 50 minutes, and after that it will expire. I'll give you the new updated data in that case. So that's where it is handy. This is how it works. Makes sense, guys, right? All right. Right. So REST is used by most of the web apps that you are seeing right now, Twitter API, LinkedIn API, Slack API, right? Foursquare, YouTube, Facebook, Zoom, all our people are still using REST in that case. And right now, if you have seen Facebook has basically mixture of APIs. It so for few part, it uses GraphQL, which is, you can say, another step or ahead of the REST API, right? It's basically kind of a on-demand client server way to communicate as an API. So that is advanced stuff. But right now, most of the API that we'll be working on are on REST. Right. Cool. Let's take a 5 minutes break. And after that, let's come back. And we're going to discuss some more what to test and after that we'll see some practical stuff in Postman from today, right? So let's take a 5 minutes break, and I'm gonna open up the timer now. And is your voice breaking? I don't think so. My voice is breaking, guys. Let me know in the comment. No. Okay. Not 5 minutes, actually. Let's take at least 15 minutes break, because we already have done 1/4. Will testing change when GraphQL is used? So GraphQL, guys, one of the thing I have seen, people, GraphQL right now, people are using it. And even few of the companies are already switched to GraphQL, and they have not implemented any kind of a REST. And GraphQL doesn't change anything from Postman side. Postman already have a support for GraphQL. Let me show you. Postman already have a support for GraphQL. Don't worry about it. So we're gonna learn also that thing, right? And I'll show you how to basically work with GraphQLs, right? If you see here, in the body part, GraphQL is already there, right? So you can have some queries as well as variables, right? So I'll prepare a demo for you guys, how to work with GraphQL, so that you will be aware as that what are the things that you should be doing as a GraphQL, right? So let's take a 15-minute break, guys, and I'll drink some water, have something, and we'll back. And after that, we'll have some session for 1 hour, max, and we'll try to cover the Postman basics today, and we'll have another session of advanced Postman with the live projects, right? So this will keep on going in that case in APIs, and we're gonna start with Postman, right? So that is a practical stuff, and theoretical stuff is important, guys, because we have to clear the interview, right? So that's why it is important to understand these concepts. Yes, perfect. So what is testing? So basically, just ignore it. So basically, what we are saying here is that what type of things that we need to be testing in the APIs, right? So there's a long list what you can test for APIs, right? So let me change it. It's as a typo. What to test in API, right? So basically, it is this. Let me change it here. Perfect. So what to test, especially in APIs, right? So generally, we talk about the test, API testing, right? It's nothing different than a normal testing that we do, right? In normal testing, normal testing is normally divided into the functional and non-functional testing, right? And in functional testing, we have furthermore divided like integration, regression, load testing, stress, security, right? So all the testing that you have seen, especially with the functional one, or already are using in, right? You can do the same thing in API testing. So that's why API testing is quite similar to the traditional testing that you have seen. And all the testing techniques, black box testing technique that you have seen in the past, right? Like boundary value, equivalence partition, all this will be similarly available, or you can use them to create the API testing test cases, right? So pay attention to this slide, because this is where people ask you what to test in APIs. So you can basically check the parsing of JSON. So most of the API that we are seeing, REST APIs, works with JSON, either with XML, right? And you can check if the JSON is getting parsed, right? What is the parse response? You can do key validation. You can check the HTTP status code. So we're gonna discuss what is HTTP code in a bit. You can verify headers. You can basically verify maximum and minimum value. You can have a test case related to JSON schema validation, which is like a structure of your API, or basically checking most of these blueprint of your APIs, if it is changing or not. You can verify API error codes, missing key updates, end-to-end chaining, end-to-end CRUD, database integrity, file upload test cases. So like there are like lots of things, and I'm going to discuss or basically give you this slide so that you can have understanding. You can test for nulls, empty string, Unicode characters, mandatory string, optional parameters, 200 bugs, and lots of things like security bugs, right? So most of the things revolves around the different testing techniques like boundary value equivalence partition, decision table, error guessing, and straight transition. Let's go one by one quickly, and so that what exactly it is, right? So whenever we are doing API testing, the first thing whenever we are preparing any kind of a test case, we do boundary value analysis, right? So boundary value analysis basically means, for example, if we have a valid input from 1 to 10, again, this is one of the few example taken from internet, so don't curse me on that, right? And if you see very small, I have already given the reference of it. So if we are considering any kind of an input box, suppose there is a particular input box for which this API was made, right? And it only can take from 1 to 10 number, right? So we are checking the boundaries like 0, 1. 0 will be invalid one and 1 will be valid. After that, we'll basically go with a 10, which is valid, and we'll go with 11, right? And we can also check for 100 also. That is again an invalid case. So in boundary values, we divide first thing, which is valid and invalid. And invalid, we'll have some boundaries that need to be checked as well as on the API side. So how are you going to do? For example, you have an API which basically takes a number that you can verify in the boundary values. If it is certain related to strings, you can check for lengths, right? You can check for different, you can apply with the length that, okay, it can take maximum or minimum length in that case. So that's where you can apply the boundary values. I hope it is clear. And second thing is equivalence partition, which is quite similar to boundary value, but it's very different way. What we do is that we basically divide any kind of a test case that we are doing. For example, let's take a simple, similar example to test a 1,000 digits, right? What you can do is that you can test for the different partitions, right? That you can divide, and you will basically do, assume that from 0 to 99 to till 3 digit, which is 999, and 1,000 to 999, for example, if you want to check it out for the 10,000 digits, you are basically created certain kind of a positive and negative, or you can say valid or invalid cases. Right here, you are not checking the valid cases or invalid cases. You are not checking the boundaries. Instead, you will pick certain number between these classes and check it out if it is works fine or not. For example, in the negative one, you will just check for -3. If it is invalid, it should be invalid in that case. You will check for any random, for example, 5, and I will check it out. For invalid one, you will just check from a different set of it. So you will basically, in equivalence partition, you will just partition your valid and invalid cases into it, and you will check between any kind of a random value that you pick. You will basically check it out for that one. Make sense? Similarly, we have decision table, which is very straightforward. Decision table is nothing but, for example, suppose we have a valid, for example, we have a username password for valid case. For example, if you see this diagram, test case one has a valid test case one. Valid username, valid password, then homepage will be seen, so execute, and rest of it is NA. If you see test case 2, will basically made a decision that if it is password is wrong, will basically show a invalid message. And rest of the three cases, it will be invalid, and if it is valid one, we are basically making a decision. So here, we have used decision table technique in that case, right? Why I'm seeing this, why we are using this black box testing technique? Similar testing, we are similar kind of approach we are using to create our test cases in APIs. So that's why it is important. That's why this revision is important. Error guessing, again, it's very simple. It basically means that, as you can see in the example, for example, we have a program to read a file. What will happen if we put an empty file, non-existing files, invalid file, invalid with UN connector? So that is again guessing, right? And that guessing comes with the experience. If you have already certain kind of experience, you will basically try out different combinations, and you will guess that, okay, this should give this error because of the code that is written. It hasn't handled the file doesn't exist, right? So that is your guessing it. And if you're getting the error, right, that's where error guessing testing technique basically makes sense, right? Is this make sense, guys? Type yes if you are able to understand these simple testing technique methods, right? Because we are going to use in APIs now. After this, right? If you have any doubt, let me know, or in the end we'll take this question, no problem with that, right? Perfect. State transition, this is one of the important testing technique. Lots of people, I'm paying attention, guys, lots of people don't know about this, and trust me, people ask about this, and trust me, try to apply this straight transition in your test cases also. right? For example, you can have a login page which basically logs after three invalid password, right? So it can have stage one, stage two, stage three, and stage four, right? So if you do a first attempt, if it is a passed, you will go to a stage two, right? If it is a fail, you will go to the second attempt, you will do third attempt, and third attempt after that, there will be account logged, right? So you will see we have different states, right? Means people can go from state one to a successful state, state two to successful state, third state to a successful state, or third state to a timeout state or account logged state. So there are a couple of states that you can go. So right now, what you can do, you can prepare to certain test cases around it. Okay, I have four cases that will basically check for the state transition. Perfect. So another important thing that we have already discussed about why we need API testing is because developer make mistake. This is the best bug that I have. If you see, so generally developers say that everything works fine in my code, everything is good, I have written unit test cases, but the problem here is the functional testing as well as integration testing. Whenever we are doing it, API testing, we found the bugs, right? And people are missing it. Now, as an API tester, now you should be aware about the security testing also. So you are responsible for any kind of a functional testing, integration testing, or even with a certain kind of a performance is expected from you, as well as the security testing. So pay attention to this, because these are the four testing important. And whenever I have seen like lots of different courses or people, we are discuss about the functional aspect of it, but the security testing as well as the stress testing that we're going to see are equally important for the API testing, API tester. Types of API testing in API, we have functional testing, right? Functional testing is nothing but checking out the full functionality of it. For example, we have a particular API for a person, right? Person information, for example, it can be name, this contain name, age, and the information about the address. So we can check functionality like, okay, name is valid or not, right? Age is integer or not, address is proper strings or not. Integration test is basically this API is used by another API. So we will basically check for integration as well as this API used by UI layer. So what is happening in that case, UI inputs are properly handled by this API or not. So theoretical concept, I know, but we should be aware of. Regression test cases, again, whatever the regression that we have made, we need to check it out. Security testing will check for the authentication. What will happen if we are doing any kind of a post request without any token, without any username password, if you are using another username password, if we are using expired username password, if you are using expired token, expired coupon, right? So this is the different kind of a security testing is involved, right? Or it can be like if I'm trying to access any kind of a admin resource from a normal user resource, right? If I'm able to access that API or not. So that's what it is. That's where it is important. Load testing and load testing, basically we'll check out different ways like, okay, if I am hitting this API for 10 seconds with the 10 different users, how it is behaving. If I do a soak testing where I'll basically keep hitting this API for 10 seconds for with 10 users for 30 minutes or 1 day, what will happen to the server, how your server is scalable to understand this. So this is mostly come under the load testing, stress testing, or soak testing, right? We're going to discuss a couple of scenarios about it, how you can test it out. Penetration testing is basically we'll try to get the access and penetrate through the API. We'll basically try to get access to the database of and we'll try to fetch different, for example, if we have a particular user which doesn't have any kind of a privilege, we'll try to get token of APIs for admin, I mean to say, and different person, and we'll do the penetration testing in that case. First testing, which is important for API testing, is basically we are discussing any kind of a coding errors, like different HTTP methods should be there. And suppose you have made a simple GET request, it should give you a success 200, okay, but right now it is giving 500. So what is happening? If we have made a mistake in GET call, server is giving us a graceful proper error or not, that's we need to check in first testing, right? So these are the things that you'll be doing, and these are the testing you'll be doing. So pay attention, note down this type of testing, because you will be asked about this, right? So let's come to the difference between the SOAP and REST that we are there. These are like two different types of web APIs that you have seen. SOAP is a protocol. Again, REST is the architectural style that we have seen. SOAP basically uses XML most of the time, and it's very simple. It's a function driven. Let me give you a very simple example of SOAP. SOAP can be, for example, if you have a particular endpoint, and in the SOAP, most of the only HTTP method that we use is POST method, and I'm going to explain you what is a different type of HTTP methods. But SOAP uses POST as the majority of it, and it's very similar. For example, you want your temperature to be converted into Fahrenheit. If you send the Celsius, it will convert into Fahrenheit. If you send in Fahrenheit, it will convert into Celsius, right? So you will have a particular signature, you will send the response, send a request, server will convert and give it back to you. And all the things are in XML format, right? In a simple manner, SOAP is like an envelope that you have seen, extra overload, more bandwidth, it has a different message that you can see, and REST is like a simple postcard. Lightweight, can be cached, easier to update, right? This is one of the simple example, and this is the important slide. Make sure you read it properly, right? SOAP is a protocol and REST is architecture style. SOAP uses XML, REST uses HTML, XML, JSON, right? SOAP generally use WS, Windows Security, as well as SSL. So it use SSL as well as HTTPS. SOAP require more bandwidth. REST is lightweight because directly we are using HTTP methods, right? SOAP is also using HTTP method, but it's a very simpler way. All right, so this is the client structure architecture that you have already read most of the time. We have client, which basically makes an HTTP request, and server will basically give you a HTTP response, right? And if you see, as different type of HTTP methods, we have get, head, post, put, delete, connect, option, trace, patch, right? And now let's pay attention to it, and let me give you every HTTP method about it. And pay attention, because this is important. People will ask you what is the difference between patch and put. And you, if you are confused, they will basically reject you most of the time in that case. So pay attention. If we are making a get request is mostly used to fetch any kind of a resource. So what do you mean by resource here is that you are using any kind of an API to fetch an information. Even if you are making, whenever you are typing google.com, you are simply making a HTML resource request from the Google server, right? And you are using get method to do that. Make sense? So get is generally used to fetch any kind of a resource, right? And everything, every data that you send is basically comes into the, it will basically go through the URL APC. So let me show you practically how the things are doing. We can go to this website, dummy web, this, and let me share the URL also here. You can play around. This is a dummy API, right? And if you see, right, let me install one JSON Chrome plugin. So you can install the JSON Chrome plugin so that you can have some good view for the JSON. Okay, so it is already installed. Okay, right. No problem. Right. So if you see, we are making a simple GET request, right? And right. So this is the basically the endpoint. We are fetching user. We want page is equal to 2. Right, we want to fetch the page equal to 2. If you do page is equal to 1, right, it will give you the different result. Right, it will give you the different result in that case. Right, so we are making a simple GET request. So you can fetch a single user. If you do a single user, it will be like this. If you are using this is a query param, and this is a path param. Right, so there's a difference between path param and query param. So query param looks like with a question mark page is equal to. And path param is generally with a slash whenever we are using the path. So there are two ways to basically make a particular URL, right? So one important thing I would like to tell you is that this is your traditional URL that you have seen, which is HTTP. So we are telling we are using HTTP, right? Which is Hypertext Transfer Protocol, right? We are using S, basically means secure version of it. Right, double quotes request.in. Request.in is basically will resolve to certain IP, right? And we want IP is nothing but a particular kind of a address on a www, which is web right? So we are saying on this server we have this API folder with the folder of users. We want the page is equal to one users, all the users. So here, if you see, it is returning any kind of a resources. And right now, if you see, we are using query param. Query params are page is equal to one. So we can have more query param with the and. For example, and A is equal to B, it will behave like the same, right? So what exactly going on is that till here, server is basically not responding back or not will not take care of this. Right. If it is able to understand this thing, it will basically reply back with you. Right. But here, if you see path param, right, it will basically return you the only single user with the ID 2. Right. So if you say here pop, it will give you error or empty response here in that case. But if you have seen with the query param, if you add extra query param, if server was not able to handle it properly, it will not give you error. It will just give you the information where it will able to understand it. Make sense, guys? Yes, you are able to understand the get. So let's make a simple get request in Postgres. Right? Type yes in the comment, guys, if you are able to understand. Okay. Pay attention, guys. Pay attention. Right. I hope everyone has installed the. So let's do one thing. Let's create a new workspace. Let's call it as that. Hello. Right. Like create a new workspace. Right. So right now, whenever you will basically install the Postman first time, right, you will see this front page. Right, where you can basically toggle the dark mode if you want to. You can use enable launchpad, right? This is enable launchpad in that case, right? And it will basically say that you can do a couple of things. You can create a new request, create a collection, environment, create an API, and couple of more tasks, right? First of all, why we are using Postman? Postman is basically a tool to create. Basically, if you already know that Postman is not a tool for API testing, it was made to basically monitor and create or help developer to create more APIs, right? Right now, as a tester, we use the Postman because different STPV methods that we have discussed, right? Like post, put, and patch, we cannot make them directly with the browser. So if you see, we can make the GET request in the browser, but they are like different post calls, which we cannot make directly because they require certain kind of a payload to be mentioned. We cannot directly make through them using the browsers, right? So we need to use certain kind of external tool, which is known as, which is basically we are using is Postman. And if you see, apart from Postman, you can use PACT, PACT for API testing. There is another there, which is Postwoman. Right, it's a web client of Postman. They have changed the name now. Hopscotch. Right, it's a very similar one, but it's right now, if you see, it's a website. You can do the similar stuff like Postman. So there's a Postwoman. Now they have changed to Hopscotch. Okay, it's a similar way, right? So we prefer Postman because most of the time people are using it, Postman, for the API testing. And we are also initially will start with this one. We'll use this one. Right. So I was talking about the different HTTP methods. So get is simple. So suppose I want to make a simple get request, right? So this is a simple get request. Get request, I have already told you, you can make the get request by browser also, right? And if you refresh this, if you open the developer tool, you will see that request is made. And let me show you the different things about it. So request URL, if you see, we have HTTPS secure version. This is the endpoint and this is the get request that we are making. Request method, Chrome is already telling us we are using get method. This is the status code we are getting, which is 200, right? So if you have seen here, we have a different status code for every kind of it. So let me see HTTP status code. Another, let me give you one more important resource. Yes. So what is HTTP status code? Make sure you note that. Swagger, we can use that Swagger also. But right now we are using it for our postman in that case. Yes, Shirni, yes. So HTTP status code is basically the status code basically talk basically tells you about what kind of response that you already have. For example, I have made a request for a get. If I'm getting a success, so 200 accesses basically means a success. So the, all these falling under are successful resources. So it means everything works fine, right? So for example, if you're getting 200, okay, all the star marked here, generally people ask the question about it. So what is actually 200? Okay. So you can read more about it if you click on it. So it means basically request has succeeded. And the information returned with the response, it depends on the method which say basically say get. And they are basically telling you that 200 OK basically means everything works fine. Whereas if you talk about 201 is whenever you have the request has been fulfilled and we have created a new resource, right? So for example, if we have made any kind of a post request to create a new student record, if we are getting 201, it basically means new student is added. For example, I have two students right now, Pramod and Chandan. I want to add third Amit. So I'll do a post request and it will basically return me with a 201. And in Postman, you will see that, let me show you where you can see the status code. So let's make our first request. Click on this plus icon, close the launchpad. And if you see here, you will see different HTTP methods, right? There are a couple of more methods you don't need to know, but the most important one is get, post, put, patch, delete. Up to here, these are important 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These five methods are enough, and they are basically are called as CRUD. And if you know how to use all these methods, most of the time your API testing is now, basically you will say that, okay, I have worked with this whole end-to-end CRUD, right? So the first request that we are making is get request. And here, this is the URL bar where you can add any kind of a request. And if you see, we have two options, which is send and download. So send and download, what exactly it will do is basically, it will send the request, whatever the response we are getting, it will basically save to our system, right? We don't want that as of now. And you can save the request. So saving here is basically means that if you want to reuse this somewhere, reuse this, you can use the save method in that case. Whenever we are getting creating a collection, it will basically learn about it. So right now we are making our first request. Now the important point here is that I want to make this request, right? And here I can click on send button, and if you see, it's basically sending the request. And after that, if you see, we have body, which is prettified JSON, which is coming. And this is the response sent by the HTTP bin server, right? Here they have sent it. And now this is the important tabs. These are the four important tabs that you should know for a postman. If you know these tabs, definitely most of the things will be covered. So the first thing is query param, right? So query param, as we have discussed earlier for this demo, where it is, right? If you see, if I replace the URL, you will immediately see that keys like page and A, so for example, these keys, right, automatically added here, right? So you can add any key. For example, if I say Pramod and the value is Datta, so you will see that it will be automatically added, right? So this is called as query params. This is called as query params. Make sense? Similarly, you can make the request for the, if you do a single thing, for example, this is the basically I want to get a user of ID two, right? So I can do the same thing. Okay, so two user doesn't exist. What is it? The single user of users? Okay, S with S. Right. So it has returned the ID, right? Details, right? So right now, if you see, it doesn't have any kind of a query param. It just have the path param. Make sense? Right. So right now, here comes the important part, which is authorization. This API is public and public basic. So the API falls under the category of public, private, and internal, right? So public URLs are URLs which doesn't require any kind of a authorization. What is authorization? Authorization is basically way of checking any kind of a resource. For example, you cannot you need username password to log into a Facebook, right? So that's where authorization comes in handy, right? So for example, suppose this is a Facebook API that we were using. So we need to use certain kind of a basic auth in that case. So we need to pass username and passwords, then only this will work, right? So that is where the authorization parts comes in, right? And we have a different authorization that we're gonna discuss one by one, right? So right now I'm giving you the gist of tabs. So we have headers. Whenever we are making any kind of a API request, we can add certain kind of a header. And here you can mention what kind of headers you want. Commonly type headers are content type is equal to JSON. For example, I'm sending this response as a request as a JSON. So I'm telling, okay, content type is JSON. Right? If you type somewhere A, you will see Postman will give you all the info, all the different headers that you can add. For example, it could be B, C, D, right? So lots of different things that you can directly add. And if you see this XX, right? These are related to some security headers. Right. In the body part, you can add, for example, right now we are making a GET request. So this doesn't require any kind of a body. GET doesn't require any kind of a body. All the information that we are sending in GET is in the parameters. So make sure you know that, right? So GET, we can only send the information that we want to send to server in the GET using the parameters, right? If it is a post call, you will see we have form data, X form data, raw, binary, and GraphQL. We're gonna learn each of them after these HTTPs, right? Pre-request is nothing but it is very similar to the before making this request. What you want, you can here you can write your JavaScript code. Right, so you can write JavaScript code here, right? So JavaScript code again, simpler way, or you can write the Postman, or you can use the Postman object, which is PM, right? So PM already provides a PM object, right? And that contains lots of different methods that you can directly use here, and we'll be using all of it, most of it. In the test part, you can write your test cases. So after, for example, we have made this request, I want to verify if my origin is this, my IP is this, then I can verify it, right? So here I can write some logic. I can write to check if my IP is 103 point something like this, right? So I can check here. Settings part, this is very simple. Like if your APIs are secure, then you can turn on the SSL. If they are not secure, you can turn it off, right? Similarly, automatic redirects, couple of follow headers, and more options for it, right? So GET is clear, guys, and Postman overview, the tab, it is clear.